Hello everyone, welcome to AVLSI lecture number 18, part number 1. So we will continue our discussion on cascode amplifier. And in the last lecture, we have seen the small signal analysis of a cascode amplifier, and we have also derived the expression for Rout, right? So this is my cascode stage. I have my M1 transistor, and top of it, I have my M2 transistor, and your M2 transistor will act as a current buffer. Right. And we have analyzed last session only, that is in the lecture number 17 point part 2, the Rout expression came out to be for this transistor over here for a cascode stage, RO2 into this big term, right, which is 1 plus GM2 plus GMB2 into RO1, the plus RO1. Okay. And the capital GM, which is the transconductance of the amplifier, came out to be same as the transconductance of your driver device, which is GM1 minus GM1. So we have already also seen that this is just the revision that the voltage gain, the intrinsic gain of a cascode stage is given by this formula, that is minus capital GM into Rout, where capital GM was minus small GM, that is GM1, and Rout was given by this expression marked in green color box. Okay. So this was just a revision. Now let us proceed ahead. Now we have we can write the Rout expression in this form, and we will further simplify it. So let's assume that if we open this bracket, right, and let's assume that this term over here is much greater than RO2, right? So we'll ignore this RO2 term. So approximately we'll get Rout is equal to 1 plus GM2 plus GMB2 into RO2, the whole into RO1. Now, if we assume that GM2 plus GMB2 into RO2 is much greater than 1, then further we can approximate Rout expression as Rout is equal to approximately equal to GM2 plus GMB2 into RO2 into RO1. Okay, so this is my approximate expression for Rout, output resistance. It is given by expression 18.1.1. Now, as we have written the expression, approximate expression for Rout, we can write the approximate intrinsic gain expression for cascode stage. And we know it is capital GM into Rout, and your capital GM is your small GM1, right? So AV will be approximately equal to minus small GM1 into Rout. And Rout is RO1, RO2 into GM2 plus GMB2. So that's the approximate intrinsic gain for a cascode stage. Fine. So let's find out what is the exact expression now. Okay, so this is the first diagram of a cascode amplifier which we have looked into, right? Wherein M1 was acting as a driver stage, M2 was acting as a current buffer, and we have a load in the form of a resistor. Then we found out Rout looking into the drain terminal of M2, and we found out that Rout was equal to expression number 18.1.3, right? We have derived it and seen it this expression a lot of times by now. Now, but what will be the total gain of your cascode amplifier? Okay, voltage gain of your cascode amplifier. So far, we have been writing the intrinsic gain. But if you want to write the voltage gain of a cascode amplifier, it will be given by minus GM1 into Rout parallel to RD. Okay, if we include the load, it will be minus GM1 into Rout parallel to RD. So while solving numericals, this formula will come into, this expression will come into handy. So don't get confused with the intrinsic gain. Intrinsic gain is of both the devices, M1 and M2 together, without RD, without connecting the load, right? Whereas the overall voltage gain is with connecting the load. So this is the expression 18.1.4 is my voltage gain of my cascode amplifier. Okay, so this first section was just the revision wherein we have just revised the intrinsic gain formula for a cascode stage, the exact formula. Then we have revised the approximated formula for Rout and the approximated expression for intrinsic gain. And later on, we also found out that the voltage gain of a cascode amplifier is given by expression number 18.1.4. Fine, so let us start with the first topic today. So first topic is based on the cascode amplifier biasing conditions. Now we have derived the expression for the voltage gain of your cascode amplifier using small signal analysis. Now it's time to you know, look into the biasing conditions for both M1 and M2, right? So remember, VB is the bias voltage such that M2 will operate in the saturation region. So let's find out this value of VB. And we have also defined one more node X. So we'll also find out what is the voltage at VX, fine, in terms of other parameters. So let us start. So first of all, for M2 to be in saturation, let me just slightly expand. Yeah. So for M2 transistor to be in saturation, VDS2 should be greater than or equal to VGS2 minus VTH2, correct? But what is VGS2? VGS2 is nothing but VG2 minus VS2. And what is VG2 over here? VB. And VS2 is VX. So VGS2 is actually equal to VB minus VX. Or if we want to write in terms of VB, so VB voltage, the bias voltage will be equal to VGS2 plus VX. Okay, clear? So we have put this expression inside the box and we call that expression as 18.1.5. Fine. Let us proceed forward. So if you see carefully in this diagram, your VX voltage is nothing but your VDS1. From this diagram, if you see carefully, your VX is nothing but your drain to source voltage for M1 transistor. So that's what we have written. VX is equal to VDS1, right? And for M1 transistor to be the edge of saturation, now for M1 transistor to be in the edge of saturation region, what should be the value of VDS1? VDS1 should be equal to, at least be equal to VGS minus VT, right? So that's what we are equating over here. VX is equal to VDS1, and that is equal to the overdrive voltage, which is VGS1 minus VTH1. So we can say VX is actually equal to VGS1 minus VTH1. And we have again boxed that equation and we called it equation number 18.1.6. Fine. Now what do we do is we found out the expression of VX. Now this expression of VX, we substitute in the expression of VB. And when we do that, the VB expression has become VB is equal to VGS2 plus VGS1 minus VTH1. Okay. And we again box this. This is an important relation. And we call it equation number 18.1.7. Fine. So this is the value for VB bias voltage. So if you are designing this VB bias voltage, it should be equal to VGS2 plus VGS1 minus VTH1. Okay, given by this expression 18.1.7. Let us look into what will be Vout. So basically, if you consider Vout, what is Vout? So Vout is nothing but the for M1 and M2 to be in saturation, your Vout is nothing but VDS2 plus VDS1. It is the overdrive voltage of M2 plus the overdrive voltage for M1. So that is what we have written over here. Vout should be equal to VDS2 plus VDS1 for both the transistor to be at least in the saturation region, right? So we have expanded this VDS2, which will be the overdrive voltage. So it will be VGS2 minus VTH2, right? Because M1 transistor, M2 transistor should be at least in the edge of saturation. So for that, VDS should be equal to VGS minus VTH, right? So Vout will be equal to overdrive voltage for M2, which is VGS2 minus VTH2, plus the overdrive voltage for M1, which will be VGS1 minus VTH1. Okay, so Vout will be the addition of both the overdrive voltages of M1 and M2. And if we rearrange it in this form, that Vout, we can write it in this form as VGS2 plus VGS1 minus VTH1 minus VTH2. And from expression number 18.1.7, what is VGS2 plus VGS1 minus VTH1? VB. So hence we can say that we substitute these three terms in place of VB, right? So Vout will be now expressed in terms of biasing voltage, VB. And so Vout will be equal to VB minus VTH2. Okay, I think it is clear how we got this. Fine with this? Yeah. So first of all, we have determined the, the conditions for M2 to be saturated. Then we found out the expression of VB in terms of VX. Then we found out what was VX. We substituted this VX in VB expression and we wrote the modified expression of VB. Now we know that output voltage is nothing but your sum of overdrive voltages of M1 and M2. So added them together and we expressed that output in terms of VB. So V out is equal to VV minus VTH2. That is an important observation. Now, let us look into details over here. For M1 to operate in the saturation region, we know that VDS1 should be greater than or equal to VGS1 minus VTH1, right? And from the diagram, what is your VGS1? Vin. And what is your VDS1? Vx. So we can say that is Vx should be greater than or equal to Vin minus VTH1. Okay, for it to operate in the saturation region. And your bias voltage VB should be chosen such that it will place M2 in the saturation region. Correct? Yeah. So this V out expression we have already seen here. It is the addition of the the overdrive voltage for M1 and M2. So basically, it is also called as it is the V out minimum, right? So it is the minimum output level for which both transistors will operate in the saturation. And that minimum output voltage level is equal to the overdrive voltage of M1 plus that of M2. So if this is V out minimum, can anyone tell me what will be V out maximum? Yeah, I have not written over here, but what could be V out maximum? This is V out minimum value, right? 18.1.9 is V out minimum value. What will be V out maximum? Yes, correct. V out maximum will be VDD minus IDRD. So what is the V out maximum? Okay, it will be VDD minus IDRD, and V out minimum will be the overdrive voltage of M1 plus M2, right? So this was about the biasing conditions for a cascode amplifier. Okay, so I will keep it for a few seconds over here. You can have a look at it. So these results of VB and V out and VX, the expressions, will be helpful for solving the numericals. Let's say if you want to find the value of VB such that M2 remains in saturation. So you have to use one of these formulas or expressions. Okay, so let's move on now. So we have already seen the R out expression, the voltage gain expression for a cascode amplifier using small signal analysis. And now we move on to the large signal behavior for a cascode stage or your cascode amplifier, fine? So this is my cascode arrangement. Your M2 transistor is stacked over M1. M1 is acting as a driver, and we have a resistive load in the form of RD. Now, since it is a cascode stage, the transistors are connected in series. So the current flowing through ID M2 transistor, which will be ID2, will be equal to ID1, and that will be equal to ID. And what will be your V out value? V out expression will be VDD minus IDRD, right? So now let us look into some details about the large signal behavior for this. Now, let's consider M1 transistor. When the M1 transistor will be off? M1 transistor will be off whenever its VGS value is less than VTH1. So what is VGS value? Vin. So whenever Vin value is lesser than VTH, my M1 transistor is off. And whenever my M1 transistor is off, my ID1 will be zero. If ID1 is zero, ID2 will be zero. That means M2 is also off. That means the current ID flowing in the network is zero. So in this formula, if you substitute ID equal to zero, what will be V out? V out will be equal to VDD. Okay. So whenever both the transistors are off, my output voltage, or for very small value of input lesser than VTH, my output voltage is almost equal to VDD. And that is what is shown over here. This is the graph of V out versus V in and Vx versus V in, right? So as you can see, for very low values of input V in fact, less than VTH1, my output value will be almost equal to VDD. Correct. Now, let us now, so my maximum output voltage swing here will be VDD, right? And now next we see what will be the Vx voltage. Now over here we have written Vx voltage is almost equal to VB minus VTH2, right? Let us see how it has come up. So for either of the transistor to be in the saturation region, right? Your VGS value should be greater than VTH2. We know that your M2 transistor has to be in the saturation region, right? So for that, your VGS2 should be greater than or equal to VTH2. But now VGS2 can be written as VG2 minus VS2. And what is VG2 according to the diagram? Okay, let me just have this diagram over here. Let me copy this part. so that whenever we are referring anything, we can refer it from here. Later on, we will delete it. Yeah. So let us continue our discussion. So we were discussing what was VG2. So VG2 was nothing but VB, and your value of VS2 was nothing but VX. Is it clear? Right. So what was VGS2? VGS2 was nothing but VB minus VX, and that should be equal to VTH2. From here, we get that VX is actually equal to VB minus VGS2. VTH2, right? So that's how we write it. VX is approximately equal to, should be approximately equal to VB minus VTH2. Fine. So in this case, if my V out is VDD, right? Whenever my both the transistors are off, at that time, at least my VX value should be VB minus VTH2, right? And now what happens? Whenever V in is crossing VTH1, my M1 transistor turns on. Whenever M1 turns on, my ID1 flows. That means my ID2 also flows, because my M2 transistor is working in the saturation region. And that is set by the bias voltage VB. That means the current starts flowing. So as you can see from this formula, if the current starts flowing, my output will keep on falling down. Correct? So what do you see from this graph? If my input increases, my output is decreasing. So basically, that's why we have a negative sign in the gain formula. That means input and output are out of phase for a cascode amplifier. Correct? So that means as I increase the value of V in, my V out will keep on reducing, because my ID is keeping on increasing until it reaches the saturation region. The saturation current level. Okay. In fact, we see if we consider the channel and modulation parameter, the ID value will keep on increasing and the V out will keep on falling down. Now, what is the next? As we say that if my ID is keeping on increasing, my ID2 will increase, right? If my ID2 increases, my VGS2 will increase. Why? Because ID and VGS2 are related like this. If I increase the value of ID, my VGS2 will also increase. And if my VGS2 increases, my VX will fall down. My voltage VX will fall down. Let us understand how. So let's see over here. What is VGS2? VGS2 is VG2 minus VS2, which will be equal to VB minus VX, right? So if my VGS2 is increasing, I know my value of VB is a DC voltage, so it won't change. So if I have to increase the VGS2 value, my VX has to fall, right? Correct? So as my ID2 increases, my VGS2 increases, my VX will fall down. And that is precisely what is happening over here. As my input is increasing, right? My ID2 value is increasing. And my VX will also fall down. Fine. So now, if my Vin value is very, very large, if my Vin value is sufficiently large, two things can happen. One thing is that your VX value can fall below, Vin by VTH1. Okay. So that may drive the M1 transistor into triad region. So when M1 can go into triad region, whenever the VX value, okay, VX is nothing but VDS1, whenever VDS1 becomes very, very small, right? And when we know that the condition for the triad region is that VDS1, it's very, very small compared to twice VGS minus VT. So if the VX value, if the input keeps on increasing, the VX can, fall to a very low value. That is nothing but your VDS1. That means VDS1 of M1 transistor is falling to a very low level. So that might drive my M1 transistor into triad region. Similarly, as my output is keeping on falling down along with the VX value, my VDS2 value for M2 transistor also will keep on reducing, and it might become very less for M2 to enter into triad region. And when the transistor M1 and M2 enters into triad region, it no longer functions as a cascode amplifier. Okay. So you should keep your, bias your transistors in such a way that M1 and M2 are always in saturation. Okay. So in summary, if we see over here, this is my large signal behavior of my cascode stage. So for very small values of Vin, output is equal to VDD, and VX is equal to VB minus VTH2. As I increase the value of Vin, my M1 and M2 transistors are driven into saturation and the current starts increasing, and hence my output voltage keeps on falling down, right? So here is the brief summary of it. right? So this is the latch signal behavior for a cascode stage. Let me keep it steady for some seconds. If you have a doubt, you can ask. Or else we have completed our part on the latch signal behavior of your cascode stage. Right? If they ask you a short note, you have to explain this much. Okay, fine. So I think we have come to the end of this session. Here we have discussed the revised the approximated formula for intrinsic gain of cascode states. And then we have seen the exact formula for intrinsic gain. Then we have seen the voltage gain formula for your cascode amplifier. Then we have seen the biasing conditions. And finally, the latch signal operation. So that will be all for this session. Next time, we will start with the numerical on cascode amplifier. So until then, have a good day and thank you.